Good afternoon, everyone, and I welcome you to the second webinar for OnTrack project organized by IDEC. My name is Orestes Dayadas, and I will be your panelist for the rest of this presentation. Right next to me, we have Natasha Kazantzidou and Nefeli Dimopoulou, two excellent colleagues that are going to help us through today's process. So, first of all, before beginning anything else, we would warmly like to wish you to be safe and sound during this unprecedented situation with the coronavirus pandemic. Provided that, we can begin without further ado with our presentation. So, as I said before, this is the second out of the three presentations for the OnTrack project. The first one took place about a month ago on May, and on that presentation we covered some general aspects of the project. First of all, we talked about the concept of tracking vet graduates, giving a general overview of this whole idea. Then we made the specific focus at the vet tracking for the vet institute level and which benefits can the vet providers get from this process. Right after, we had a brief presentation for the approach, methodology, and tools of the OnTrack project, and of course, the practical benefits that your organization can get by enrolling into this program. And of course, by the end, we had a brief question and answer section. So, for those of you who want to rewatch the first presentation, it is of course available on YouTube. You can whether click on this link when our presentation is our today's session is published, or alternatively you can scan with your mobile device the QR code that is found right below. So, moving forward from yesterday to today, what are we going to talk about today? We're going to expand a little bit the concept of tracking vet graduates at vet institute level. We're going to have a kind of deeper focus, deeper than the last time, on the methodology and the tools of OnTrack. We are going to analyze the two main ways in which you can enroll your organization. One way is the Google Forms questionnaire and the other one is the LEM survey questionnaire. We're going to have a hands-on presentation about its use, and of course we're going to answer any questions that you may have. More on that later, and for right now, we just would like you to help us with a very brief poll regarding your participation in the previous webinar. So, if you are kind enough, you could answer right now to our poll. There are three possible questions. One is yes. Yes, I attended the webinar last time. The other one is no, but I have seen the video recording. And the third one is once again, no, and neither have I seen the recording. We do hope that you do not go for the third one, but it's up to you. We are sorry, it seems that we had a little bit of a difficulty with the poll. So I guess that we're going to check the results later, or perhaps we are going to have the suspense of not knowing them. Well, okay, so right now, let's move on to the on-track project in a nutshell. And for this reason, I would like to give the floor to Mrs. Nataza Kazantzidou, who will guide you to the rest of the presentation. Thank you very much for hearing.
Hello from my part. I'm Nataza Kazantzidou. Those of you that have attended the first webinar, you already have seen me. We had a difficulty with the poll. We were not able to do the poll, how many of you attended the first webinar, but I will ask you to use the raise your hand facility. Those of you that attended the first webinar or saw it afterwards in YouTube, please raise your hand just to have an idea if you already know about the project or should I repeat some stuff. So please, if you have attended the first webinar, raise your hand. I will wait some seconds. Okay, so I count only five people that participated, that joined the first webinar out of 22. So I'm going to repeat some information. I'm sorry for those five of you that you will listen it again, but just to be on the same page with the new people, the people that are following, are attending now. So the OnTrack project is an Erasmus Plus strategic partnership in vocational education and training. It is led by the Technical University of Košice. It has started in November 2018, and it's supposed to end at 2020, October 2020. However, we're going to get an extension of the duration due to delays that we experienced with the COVID crisis. The website of the project is www.ontrack-project.eu. And this is where you can find all the information of the project. Currently, we are in the process of finalizing all the main outputs of the project, and we are about to start piloting the main project results. And that is why we are having this webinar. This is part of the exploitation of the project results. This is a photograph from the last meeting and training that we had in January. That was the last time that we gathered all together, the partners all together physically, because since then we only meet virtually, like all people in Europe. And okay, let's start with the methodology. For VET graduating tracking system, what I'm going to present at the moment is the overall methodology, not focusing only on on-track project, but the general methodology that the VET provider can follow in order to build, to establish a VET graduate tracking system. Sorry. So the next, the first thing that we look when we build anything, when we establish a new process, is why we do that, to define the objectives and the overall strategy. The next step is to define the indicators, which are the indicators that we want to measure through a VET graduate tracking system. And then we go to the methodology. Methodology and resources, these steps are very close together, because the resources that we can devote are interrelated with the methodology that we use. Finally, we have a process for the evaluation, the data analysis, and the use of the results. Regarding the objectives, when we try to establish a graduate tracking system, we need to know why. Why we get into this trouble, because it's not something easy. Why we want to establish such a system. It may be a requirement from the government. It may be a requirement from our stakeholders, from our funders, or it may be a wish of our own institution in order to improve. In any case, we need to find what is the need that we're trying to cover. Is it something compulsory to do, or is it something voluntary and we do it on our own in order to improve ourselves? Then we need also to think about what we will do with the information that we will gather. That means that, okay, we run a survey and we have some information, some knowledge. How are we going to use this knowledge in our processes? This is something that we need to think beforehand, because there is no point to run a survey to gather information and then to do nothing. If there is no room for changes, if, for example, in some countries, public institutions, they have a very strict curriculum, they have very strict processes, and they have very little freedom to manage things. So in that case, the objectives are different, and we need to know it in order to look into information about things that we can change, that we can influence. The next step, we define our objectives and then we define our strategy. Here we need to answer questions like how often the tracking will take place. Is it one-off activity? Is it something that we do once and do not repeat? Or is it something regular? And if it's regular, how often are we going to do it? Every year, every 2 years, every 5 years? This is also connected with the strategy of the institute and the planning of the institute. If the institute has a roadmap for 3 years, maybe it makes sense to do also a tracking survey every 3 years. This is something that the institution has to decide. We need to decide how comprehensive it will be, how long the survey will be. Are we going to focus on few important indicators, or it will be exhaustive and we need a lot of information that can be used for improvement? The methodology that we will talk about roughly in the beginning, we need to know what kind of methodology will be used, if it will be a survey, questionnaire-based survey, or it will be interviews or other methods of research. We need to decide if it will be a sample survey or a population survey, if it will cover all our graduates or a sample of graduates. This has to do also with the size of the institution. For some big organizations, big vocational centers, it may make sense to have a sample survey instead of a population survey, where in smaller centers we can do with the same resources population survey. We may decide also to have a survey on specific schools, on specific departments of our center. What resources are you willing to put in place? So that means how many staff members, how much time are we willing to devote into that? If there is a need for a cost, for a real cost, for example, to buy equipment, software for survey, or to buy some software for data analysis, are we willing to pay for that? This has to do with the resources. And Finally, how the results of the tracking system will be used, and if it's for improvement, how they will feed into the system, into the decision management system, what are we going to do with the results? So these are all questions that we need to think beforehand, before we get into the trouble of organizing a tracking system. We need to think about the strategy, why we are doing that, which methods are we going to use, resources that we are going to devote. This is important because at the end we may do a lot of work and find out that we need to spend so much time that the cost benefit is too much cost for a little benefit. Let's progress. So we know about the objectives. Our objectives, we know our strategy roughly, and then we talk about indicators. What kind of indicators do we set for our survey? The indicators should be based on the objectives of the tracking system and should respond on the needs for information. If we need to gather information about employment of graduates, we need to set indicators about employment. If we want to measure skills, our indicators will be about skills. If we want to measure quality of our education, of the provided education, there are different indicators to measure that. So in any case, we need to know what we want to measure and to set our indicators. The indicators will guide our data collection, will guide our tools. The set of indicators, the setting of indicators is important because we determine what type of data we want to gather, and in a realistic and effective manner. So we need to think in a forward, to think about what type of data is it realistic to gather, and set indicators accordingly. It's easier to measure, for example, if the graduates are employed or if are not employed. This is something that can be measured easily. It's more difficult to measure perceptions, quality issues, or some other qualitative indicators. In this stage, we need to define indicators that will guide the rest of the process. We have here, I don't know if you see it. Yes, we have an example of indicators. These are examples of indicators that are taken from the bibliography, from other surveys, tracking surveys across Europe. So we have, for example, indicators about gender representation in studies in specific fields or in employment, percentage of students that follow continuing studies, percentage of students that are employed or unemployed, indicators regarding the salary, indicators about the jobs that the graduates follow, sectors of employment or specific occupations. And then we have qualitative indicators like proposals for changes, like satisfaction with career guidance, like satisfaction with the job, like matching between graduate skills and job requirements. When you design your own system, you need to choose you have a look in the bibliography. Fortunately, you don't have to look to search for a bibliography, because we have done it in OnTrack for you. So we have a study that is brief enough, but comprehensive, and you can review to see what others have done and then choose your own approach. When we define our indicators, the next step is to do the data collection. And here we have some methods that we can use. We can collect primary data. That means data that we collect ourselves with instruments that we develop, that is appropriate for our own needs and for our own survey. The most common methods to gather primary data are the questionnaires, interviews, and focus groups. At least these are the methods that we use in our approach. And then there are also secondary data that can be used, like administrative data. In the case of vet centers, vet providers, administrative data can mean enrollment, registry of students, students' records, grades, performance, student records from work-based learning, from periods that they did in companies, and different administrative data that already exist in the institution. There is also the possibility to combine primary data and secondary data. And in national surveys, not at the level of vet institution, but at the level of country or a region, administrative data collected through the statistical services, the National Statistical Office, can also be used, like employment or salaries or educational level, or data that can be gathered through annual census. In our case, in our OnTrack project, we'll explain it later, we use primary data collected through questionnaires, interviews, and focus groups. A few words about the development of a questionnaire. If you want to build your own questionnaire, if you want to develop your own questionnaire, some tips on how to do that. As I told before, we always start with a list of indicators. We start with a list of indicators in order to pose the questions. We need to know what information we're trying to gather. We formulate the questions clearly. We make sure that the questions are understandable by our audience. We need to have in mind that we are talking to graduates, so the language that we use should be appropriate for them. Don't use language that is only understandable by educators or by people that work in the vocational education. Avoid complex or combined questions. Avoid questions that you ask two things in one question. This may be a trick to reduce the size of questionnaire, but it's not a good idea, because it doesn't give the possibility to the responder to really reply to the question. Make sure your responders can answer the question and are willing to answer the question. This has to do also with the ethical code. You don't ask questions that may be offensive. This may be also cultural, depend on the culture of your country. In some countries, it may be offensive to ask about the salary or the age, or I don't know. And also, the responders will be able to ask to reply to the questions. They have the knowledge to reply to the question. When we use rating scales, we need to be very clear and to have a balance in rating. If we have scales between something negative and something positive, it needs to be balanced. It needs to. It can be with different number of options, but in any, it can have a middle point or no middle point. But in any case, it needs to be balanced. You cannot have five replies that the four are positive and only one is negative, or the vice versa. And it needs to be clear, so that the responder can pick one answer without hesitating. At the end of every questionnaire, we gather some demographic data. Demographic data are, for example, the age, the gender, and some personal information about the responders. We don't need to gather data if we're not going to use them. So it makes no point to ask about the gender if we don't use it in our analysis. If in our analysis we don't make analysis depending on the gender of the responder or on the age. So make sure that you gather only the necessary demographic data. Next, once we have the questionnaire, it's very important, before we run the survey, it's very important to test, to pilot test the questionnaire on a small sample of people. It's better to test the questionnaire with people that are among your audience. It doesn't make any sense to give it to teachers. It makes sense to give it to young people or students, or even better if you have you can approach some graduates. With this small testing, you can see if the questionnaire works, if you gather the right information, if it's easy, if it's clear for them to reply, and all these parameters that are important to make a valid, credible survey. So we pilot the questionnaire and then we are ready to run the survey. If it's a case to do a sampling, we do sampling. If we use a sample, it's better to be randomized. Otherwise, it's not. It may bias the results. If it's a convenience sample, it may bias the results. As we are talking about systems, tracking systems at the level of a vet provider, if the size of your institution is not too big, then you can avoid this step and go directly to the survey. You can address the whole population. For example, if your graduates of the last year are if you have few hundreds of graduates, then it doesn't make sense to do only, to send the survey only to a sample. Have in mind that not all of your recipients will be willing to answer your survey. So you will lose, already you will lose some recipients. Okay, this is sampling then. If it's an online survey, that's most probable in nowadays, everybody is using an online survey. And one more reason is that we're talking about graduates. You don't have access to your graduates. They don't come anymore to your organization. So how you're going to approach them? Through an online questionnaire. There are different tools that you can use. We have written here indicatively Google Form, SurveyMonkey, Lime Survey, EU Survey, but there are much more. There are open tools that you can use, free tools, and there are also some survey tools that you have to pay some subscription. They are easy to use. especially Google Form and EU Survey are pretty easy to use even with non-technical, not very advanced technical skills. Easy to track, easy to analyze. All the tools provide some basic descriptive statistics at the end. And you can have, you can increase the outreach with online survey. There are different possibilities to invite your recipients. You can invite them through an online survey system. All the online survey systems have an embedded subsystem that you can put the email addresses of your recipients and contact them directly. Or you can use another email program and send the link of the survey to your participants. And this is a direct way to approach graduates. If you have their contact details, it's it may be easier for you to approach them through an email or through the online survey system. If you want to run a survey and reach past graduates or graduates that we don't have the contact details, you may also opt to publish the survey in social media or in events that you organize. With this option, you may run the risk of having collect replies that are not valid, replies that are for people that are outside your target group. But if you don't have any other way, this is also an option to use social media or other ways to approach your recipients. Now we're moving on a slide that said this is the most difficult part of running a survey, to get responses. And if you have done surveys in the past of whatever nature, you know that this is the most difficult part, because it's not something technical that you can fix easily. It needs to cultivate what we say a feedback culture, a culture that the people have are willing to provide you with feedback. And this is not something that you can do in easily or in a short time. This is something that it needs to grow gradually. When we establish such a tracking system, we can use different methods to approach recipients and see what works best. We said in the previous slide that we can have a direct email, we can approach through the system or through the social media. That this is something that you have to work to find out the right solution. But then still, you cannot expect a very big response rate. Still, the people that are willing to answer may be few of them, a small percentage of your whole list of recipients. You need to provide a good reason to fill in the survey. You need to find the right motivation. This depends very much on the culture. In some cases, you may need to provide an incentive like motivation, like a gift, or like you can participate in a lottery and win something, or a real motivation, something tangible. In some other cases, you need just to provide a good reason that if you fill the survey, this helps us improve, this helps us provide better learning to the young generation, this will improve employability. Find your own reasons to motivate people. Remember that you're talking to young people, graduates that are in the first youth years, or in some cases, they may be also teenagers. Very important is to keep open channels with graduates through other activities. That is, cultivate an alumni culture. Engage them with events, with newsletters, with career days, with opportunities for employment. There are different channels that you can use to engage, to keep open doors with your graduates. It's very important, another point, it's very important to use the feedback. That means, okay, we run the survey, we have this information, we need somehow to use it. How we use this information? We improve ourselves, we improve our learning. We got feedback that, for example, the career orientation that doesn't work very well, we're going to change it. So the people want to see a real impact of their action. They answer to your survey and then you do something with that. You do something with their feedback. And of course, we need to communicate this action, because if you do something and we don't communicate it, nobody knows afterwards. These are some tips to start. Remember that every year, if you set up a permanent system, every year the participation rate will increase. With constant efforts and with some tricks, you build gradually, you build engagement, and you motivate people to participate in your tracking survey. So you cannot give up. You don't give up with the same try. You may send in the first time, you may send questionnaires and get only 10% or 50% of responses. It's small, but it's not nothing. It's something that you can start and you can build. And the next year it will be better, and the next year it will be better. And this is how you build, you cultivate a culture of feedback, a culture of quality. So this was about the methodology, and we're going to see in the next slides about the on-track methodology, the specific methodology that we have used. Now, a few words about the resources. We said that you need the resources to do this thing. You need a team of people, you need a staff that they will cooperate to make this a project. You need to deal with it as a project. You need someone as a leader, you need someone as an administrator to find the contact details, to keep to contact the graduates, to gather the responses, to keep track, to monitor the whole process. You need someone to deal with the technical part, the tool, the online tool that you will use. You need someone to analyze the results. Here we have four different roles. It doesn't mean that you need to have four people. And it doesn't mean that these four people will work for a long time. But you need to have these skills. So see it as different skills. It may be one person that is a technician, can deal with the technical stuff, but can also deal with the administrator, or someone who is the project manager, the project leader, but also do the analysis. So see it as different skills that you must have in your team. Then you need some training. It can be a formal training, or it can be a briefing, or a non-formal training. Somehow you need a process to build all these people together in this project, in this tracking system. And of course we need time. Time Time is an important parameter. When you start doing this, you need to set your time plan. You need time to set your strategy. You need time to prepare your questionnaire. You need time to run the survey. You need time to analyze the results. All these steps need time and involvement from different people. Regarding the timing of the survey, think about which is the most appropriate time to use to run the survey in terms of other tasks that are running. For example, if you have exams, this is not a good time to introduce such a system. If during the summertime, graduates are on vacation, or you need to think about the proper timing of the survey. Normally, when you run an online survey, you give a period of 2 or 3 weeks, at least 2 or 3 weeks, in which you may send, you launch the survey, you send the questionnaire, and then you may send a second invitation or a reminder after 1 week or 10 days. And usually, when you send an online survey, usually you get the responses, the bulk of the responses, you get it the first 2 or 3 days. After that, you don't have any more response. So people, when they receive such an invitation, either they reply right when they receive it, or they don't reply at all. So have this in mind when you schedule the running of your survey. And if there's a need for a reminder, have also that in mind. In total, I would say that you should devote a period of at least 1 month to run the survey. And we come to the results, the outputs. We have the survey outputs. If we have used an online survey system, we have some first report or descriptive statistics of our results. If we have, depending on the size of our sample, if we have a lot of results, we may do a step of data cleaning, especially if the survey is run through, is communicated through a social media. This is an important step, data cleaning. And then we have data analysis, interpretation, and visualization. We need to see what people answer. We will have an analysis regarding different parameters. For example, if we are a vocational center that we have different fields of studies, we may analyze the results per each field of study. Especially employment indicators are very much depending on the specific field of study. Some occupations have easier employment than others. You can use the parameters that you want to analyze your results, and then you interpret your results. You need to transform the information that you get into knowledge, to derive some conclusions from the results that you have. And then visualize the results in diagrams or charts to make them presentable in a clear way. Outputs, the possible outputs of a survey, the most common is a report. We produce a report. If there is a need, we can produce also executive summary if we have stakeholders to present the results, or a short presentation, or articles or press releases This depends on what we said in the beginning on the strategy, what we're going to do with the results. So what, why we run the survey, it also reflects on how we present the results and to whom we present the results. So we continue. And then the next step is how, what we're going to do with the results. The main purpose of doing a non-tracking survey or in a tracking survey in a vet institution is to use it for our own improvement. So that means integration within the quality assurance system to improve educational and support services, to improve the learning of students, to improve career orientation or other services, the work-based learning, other services that we provide to students. We need a process to feed the results into the decision-making system, to feed the results into the management review process. Apart from that, there are also other uses of the results, other possible uses that are, for example, to feed national or regional information systems that have to do with tracking graduates or to compare, to benchmark with national data or other vet institutions. If we are talking about vet providers that have different centers, different schools in different parts of the country, that may be also used to compare between them, to benchmark, to exchange knowledge between them. This is another possible use of the results. So that was a general presentation, how we do tracking system. Now we're going to present a little bit more about OnTrack, what we developed in OnTrack. We used this methodology, we built on this methodology that we presented, and we have developed some tools. In our project, we have used a standardized online survey as a methodology that includes a set of standard questions, compulsory questions, and a set of complementary questions. Additional questions that are optional. The rationale behind that is that we need something brief so that we have a lot of responses, but then we need some optional questions so as to gather information from a smaller sample of people, but in more information, in-depth information about quality. And then we have an option to follow up questions through interviews. So if people are willing, they can provide their email and they can participate in an interview that is after the survey. In OnTrack, the survey is will run every year. And there are two different groups of graduates that will be addressed. The one is the recent graduates, the ones that finished the year before. And a second one is the graduates that have finished 2 years ago. So that means that from now on, the partners that will establish such methodology will run the survey twice for every single participant. So the graduates will receive one survey when they graduate and one more after 2 years. And this is a way also to keep to measure the progress of indicators within the years, within time. Another feature of OnTrack methodology is that we have produced three different questionnaires that correspond to three different levels of vocational education and training. With OnTrack questionnaires, we are measuring a set of 9 indicators that are in the field of employment, further education, and the link between these two aspects and the received education and learning. So these are the set of 9 indicators that we have measured in our approach. And we have produced tools to cover all needs. Now I'm going to give the floor back to Orestes. Thank you for keeping up with me. Orestes will present the technical part, the tools that we have produced, and then I will be back for questions and answers. So I give the floor to Orestes.
So, thank you very much, Natasa,
for this very nice presentation. So, as I promised before,
I'm giving you the technical part of the OnTrack survey, which is of course no other than the produced questionnaires that we have. And we're going to give a quick look at them, both through the Google Forms and the Lime survey platforms. So, without further ado, let's see the Google form, and here we have to begin with a welcome message that we get. Let's suppose that we are one student that has just received this questionnaire. He or she opens up the link, and there off we go to the Google Forms answer. Well, I suppose that most of you are already familiar with Google surveys, since they are the most common form of survey out there. And so we begin with a welcome message that says a few things about the OnTrack project, the goal of this questionnaire, the things that are going to be examined, and of course that the data are going to be confidential. Although it sounds kind of a typicality, you definitely have to include it in your welcome message in order, you know, some people are more cautious about this stuff. So we hit next and we move on to the first section. So we, as you can see, we begin with some very, very basic and easy to answer questions, like the year that you graduated. And here is the first customizable question. Well, many of the questions of the survey are going to include the name of your institution. So when you receive the questionnaire from us, it also comes with a technical manual with a step-by-step tutorial along with pictures on how you can put the name of your institution on the questions. And also here is another customizable drop-down menu. What you see here as A, B, C, and D is actually going to be the study fields of your institution. Like it could be, let's say, gastronomy, arts, media, engineering. Let's suppose that it goes on with logistics, with aesthetics, and so on and so on. After you put all your stuff here, well, the student is going to actually see the fields of education of your institution. So we move on to some net as we call it, like questions where they have to evaluate a certain skill as very strong, strong, weak, and so on, and so on. As you can see, it is pretty analytical so that we can cover all the data that Natasha talked to you about. And so the interesting thing is that in our questionnaire, there are the so-called branch questions. That means that the follow-up to the questionnaire depends on what the student is going to answer. For example, here it says, did you participate in mobility abroad during your studies at name of school? Which, as I already said, you have to put in. So if the student says yes, then up to the next field, we're going to have this mobility abroad related question, which if the student had answered no to this question, then it doesn't exist. It moves right next to the next question. And this is a feature that happens with many questions. Depending on the answer, you get the corresponding follow-up. So in work for this work placement question, in the same way, if you hit yes, then it goes to the next and it asks about the work placement. But if you hit no, then you may have guessed right, it moves on to the next questions. So here you can see some questions about whether you continued your education after graduation, your educational field that holds your highest qualification. And apart from the questions that have only one answer, as you can see here, we also have the ones where you can pick more than one, like three, four, and so on. So once again, are you currently employed? If you hit yes, we go on to employed themed questions, your current main employment status, and so on and so on. But if you hit no, then we go to unemployed themed questions, as you can see here. So yeah, that's something that that offers a tailor-made experience to the student. According to his or her situation, then he or she receives the corresponding questions that target the situation that the student is in. So in this way, we move on to a couple of more questions. And we, after all the study and work related questions are over, then we move on to the typical part of the demography. The student can choose from a pretty wide range of countries the country of his or her residence. If you're not living in the country where you studied, why didn't you note? Year of birth. Okay. And what is your gender and family income? As Natasha said before, all these data are going to be analyzed and used. We never put a question that is out of context and it's not going to be analyzed. I forgot to mention before that you can also highly customize your questionnaire and pick if you want to subtract some questions or perhaps add some new ones according to your needs. Well, what we give you is the recommended structure, the recommended list of questions, but of course, depending on the needs and the style of your institution, you can make it tailor-made to your needs. So after a couple of more questions, there we have the contact details, which of course are optional. The student has the choice to leave the name, perhaps a contact number, an email address, home address, social networking address, and so on, to mention the ways in which he or she wants to be notified in the future about the news of your institution. And all these, of course, are of course optional. The survey can be completed even without them. And finally, we move on to a very important question. At the end, the student is taking this question if he or she wants to answer some supplementary ones. If the student hits no, then it's or is ready to be submitted the survey, or if the student hits yes, then if the student has really that feedback culture that Natasha mentioned before, then we move on to the supplementary questions, which since they are addressing a person that wants to answer more, then they are kind of, you know, more detailed, more extended, and so on. But just like I mentioned before, you can rearrange them or limit them or expand them as much as it suits you. So you can see that from there on we go pretty analytical, because we're getting even more information about the student, not just the essential ones. And we also touch the subject of civic engagement. Like here we have the volunteering activities. There are also the participation in policy making, like trade unions, student unions, etc. We have the we have also the overall level of civic engagement that your school left the student with. And finally, right now, what you're going to see from now on is not going to be in the final questionnaire, but we saw it here for you, because it's going to be the face-to-face or group questions. So these are some questions that the student can answer from a person-to-person interview. As you can see, they are all open-ended. You know, they are not just one, two, three, but a full text. Instead, as I said before, they are not going to be included in the final questionnaire. They are here only for demonstration reasons. So after, if a student leaves the data, his contact details, and you consider that you can ask the student back for a personal interview, then you send an email, you throw a phone call or something, and if the student comes at your institution, then we provide you with these questions that you can ask face to face in order to get the absolute max amount of details that can be acquired from a student. As you can see, what are your plans for further progression and so on, and we reached the submit button. So now we're finished. And that was pretty much the questionnaire. As you saw, it was pretty analytical. We tried to cover every aspect, every important part of a student's post-graduation days, in order for you to have the ability to have the maximum amount of data you may need for your research. So this exact questionnaire comes also in another form, which is no other than the LIMES survey. It's another tool, more, let's say, sophisticated than Google Forms. Fewer people know it, but it does offer many more features and many more possibilities and flexibility for the creator of the survey. Well, but in our case, they are just, we have the exact same questionnaire. We come here with the welcome screen, and then our session has expired. Well, they were pretty much the same questions, so we weren't going to go through all of them anyway. So that's pretty much it. The questionnaires are designed for maximum flexibility, so that you can adjust them however you want. So I do hope that this tutorial was pretty much, you know, good for a first glimpse. So now I'm giving the floor back to Natasha in order to go on with your very nice analysis. Natasha?
Okay, we are back again. Okay, you have seen the two tools, the two different technical implementations, because actually the tool is the same, it's a questionnaire, but there are two different implementations, technical implementations. We recommend that you use the Google form if you have a small sample, a small target group. If you don't have someone in your team that has advanced technical skills, we recommend, on the other hand, to use Lime Survey if you are a big school, you are a big vocational education center, and if you have someone to administrate it, because it's powerful, Lime Survey, but it's more complicated. So we are these are the tools. These are our results of our project. As Orestes said, the tools are fully customizable. You can customize them. You can customize the tools. The questionnaires, as they are pretty long, but you can delete questions. You can insert your own questions. You can adapt them. You can bring them in your own to your own needs. As I said in the beginning, we are now in the phase to do the pilot. In some countries, we have already started to do the pilots, but there has been a delay in this activity due to the closure of schools. So, and now it's summer. We expect to run pilots in September, October this year. And there is still room for other organizations to participate if they want in the project pilots. How you can do that? If you are a vet provider, a vet center, you get in contact with one of the partners. You will get the questionnaire. You will choose the questionnaire that you will use. You will choose the level of your center. You will choose if you want a Google form or a Lime survey, and you can choose one of the seven languages that are available. I remind that we have all the tools implemented in English. German, Slovakian, Latvian, Greek. I have forgotten one language.
Yes,
let me finish. So you choose the tool of your choice, and then we will make a copy and we will give you access, and then you can do it. If it's a Lime survey, you can keep it in our own server. If it's a Google form, you can put it wherever you want, in a Google Drive, wherever you want. There are other tools that you can use for your support. We have a methodological guide that will be released in July, in 1 month approximately. And we have a technical manual that is how to work with the online surveys. It's purely technical. So you will have two documents to guide you through the whole process. And the other thing is that with the pilots, we do a pre-post evaluation. So we need, we want to make sure that we evaluate the results that we have built in through a non-experimental evaluation design, including a pre evaluation questionnaire and a post-evaluation questionnaire before the survey and after the survey. So if you participate in the pilots, please follow the whole process, pre and post evaluation. And of course, in this process, you will have a national partner, one of the partners, depending on your country, to help you, to support you. So now I give the floor to Orestes, that he has to add something. Prepare your questions, because we're about to start taking questions. So if you have questions, you can write them in there is a window, a small window of questions, that a tab, a small tab that you can use to post questions. So let me give the floor to Orestes, and I will be back.
So thank you very much, Natasha, once again. And because I don't want to leave our audience, you know, with complaints, well, as I promised before, here is the LIME survey interface. Now, after the small problem that we had before, so as you can see, it's exactly the same questions that are here. Is the customizable section with the name of your school. Here are the possible study fields that you can add. Of course, here we have the NET-like questions that we also mentioned before. They are the exact, I repeat, they are the exactly same ones as the Google survey, but they have, as you can see, some different colors and fonts and visual identity. But the most important thing is that for the branch questions that we mentioned before, for example, the one we saw about the mobility abroad, yes or no. And as you can see right down here, the question pops up. The answer is no. We move on to the next question. The answer is yes. The corresponding question automatically pops up into our screens. Well, that kind of saves a significant amount of time if we're talking about many questions. Where, well, as you can see here, is the same. It's a different system from Google Forms, but it's actually, you know, the same basic philosophy. So yeah, after that, we move on and on and on. So right now, now that we are absolutely finished with the technical part, there are no more surprises out there, I promise you. And I would like to give the floor to the other panelists that, if you remember, I mentioned in the very beginning, which is no other than Mrs. Nefeli Dimopoulou, who will give you some more details. Mrs. Nefeli, the floor is yours.
Hello, thank you very much. My name is Nefeli Dimopoulou and I'm a European Project Manager in IDEC. Oreste, can you please share my screen?
Of course.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm going to make a very brief presentation of a similar project, which is called ASTRE, Automatic System for Tracking E-Learners. So ASTRE is an Erasmus Plus project for adult education, which aims at developing a tracking system for MOOC learners instead of VET learners that will feed into the quality assurance system of the MOOC providers. So the project will design firstly a tracking system which will measure the benefit and the impact of attendance of e-learning courses and will support the quality assurance and the strategic planning of MOOC providers. Secondly, the project will also develop a guide which will address MOOC providers that want to implement the tracking system with their own resources and will provide step-by-step methodological guidelines, just like the OnTrack project. So for the next few months, we are also going to organize webinars for tracking MOOC learners. So if you want to find out more about the project and our activities, you can visit our webpage at the link provided in this slide, or you can also follow us at our Facebook page at ASTRE Project. I forgot to mention that the ASTRE Project is led by the Polytechnical University of Valencia, and IDEC is also part of the consortium. So thank you very much, Orestes. I give the floor back to you.
Thank you for this present, the floor. So now that Mrs. Dimopoulou is over, we can move on to your questions and answers that you may have. So as Natasha said before, feel free to ask anything that we may have missed, may didn't mention, and so on. So we are at your disposal. Well, I'm happy that we covered everything, right? If there is anything that you would like to add, yes, we have a question from Claudio Marquez. Mr. Marquez, you could whether write your question at the question section, or we could just you could speak up, write in the chat what you prefer to do. So, okay, so we have a question from Mrs. Annalisa Scadlino. Are you interested in accepting partners in the pilots from new states? Ms. Natasha? Are you interested in accepting partners in the pilots from new states? Yeah, we will need some
clarification. Yes. We can accept the questioners at the moment are in specific languages, but there is a questioner. There are all three questioners are available in English. If that works with you and if you are willing to translate, yes, of course, you can participate in the pilots. That means that you need to get involved more deeply because it needs more efforts, because you will do also the translation of the tool. But yes, in principle, you can join even if you are not in one of the partner countries.
I do hope that we covered you, Mrs. Annalisa. So we move on to Yvonne Yenken. The question is great. Thank you very much for your feedback. Was it tested? Is the question, and difference between slightly and somewhat is not clear enough. Of course, you're talking about the possible answer. So what is our view on this, Mrs. Natasha?
The questioners have not been tested at the moment. I mean, they have gone a lot of revisions, a number of revisions, but not the pilot testing. We have made we made the questionnaires in expert committees. We have done a peer review. We have done a pilot, a small sample of 15, 20 responses for its questionnaire. Now it's the time that we go to do the pilot with our target group, which is graduates. So I hope. Then there is a difference between slightly and somewhat is not clear enough. I don't have the questionnaire before me, but yeah, some phrasing may need further improvement. This is something that will be done in after the pilots. And at the moment, the English questionnaire is just as a working questionnaire. It's not something that we use because we don't have an English partner. So that means that we developed everything in English, but then the real questionnaires that will be tested will be in the national languages, not in the English. So I close the mic.
So we move on to Mr. Claudio. We're sorry, but we didn't forget you. Be sure about it. So the question by Mr. Marquez is why we as vet providers are not all focused on EQAVET system.
ECAVET system is a framework for quality assurance. So what we are covering is one component of a quality assurance system. It's not we are not doing a fully quality assurance system. We are doing only one part of it, which actually is it's very much linked to ECAVET because it is linked with the fourth criterion of ECAVET. ECAVET follows the Plan, Do, Check, Act quality cycle. So this is the tracking systems are in the act, in the improvement field, in the last part of a quality cycle, where you have done the plan, the planning, implementation, evaluation phases, and then you are in the review phases. And for this phase, you need to have information. OnTrack project deals with gathering information from one important stakeholder of the vet provision, which are the graduates, the students that have gone through the system, and they're out in the labor market or they are doing further studies and they have opinion, they have a very valid opinion on if the education provided was good or not good or how it deals, how it linked with employment. So actually the tracking system is part of the ECAVET, a very important and very neglected part, I would say, because we often work with ECAVET in the planning phase, in the evaluation phase, but it's not very common to work on the review phase and on gathering information and taking evidence-based decisions. I hope that I have answered.
And now we have one more question by Mrs. Vonne, and it is, until when do new countries should send their interest to participate? Well, that's interesting.
Now it's the moment, now in during, I mean, if you want to be part of the pilots, this is the moment to express your interest. But if you're interested to use it, to use the system without taking part in the pilots, of course, you can do it also afterwards when it's best for you. That means that if you do it now, you can participate in the pilot. The difference between the pilot or not pilot is that if you participate, if you are willing to join the pilot, then we will ask you to do also some pre-post evaluation. But you can do it, you can implement it on your own without guidance, with the standard documents that we have produced, whenever it's best for you.
Thank you very much. I think that pretty much covered it. So I see that Mr. Claudio raised his hand again. Is it true?
Claudio, you're right. Tracking of ECAVET is compulsory. However, it's not done. So it's they do not exist enough tracking systems. And that is why we have this project, because there was a priority in Erasmus Plus because there are not developed tracking system. This is obvious in the study that we have done in the beginning. And in the website, you can download the context report and you can see that there is a clear need for developing tracking systems because they do not exist.
So, all right. So do we have any other question? Any other hand raising or something that would then cover you up? Something you would like to add, subtract, mention, side note, or whatever you feel like? I think we are pretty clear. So at this point, I would like to, oh, here is a surprise from, okay, just a farewell message from Mr. Claudio. We thank you very much too. Okay, regards to you too. And I think we are pretty covered here. So, Natasha? Okay, so at this point, that it seems that there are no more questions left.
Okay, that's that was all. We have come to a finish. To brief you about the progress, you can stay in contact with us. You can visit our website and Facebook. There will be a third webinar in September. Initially, the idea was to have experience from the pilots, but we may also have some support to people joining the pilot. So it's pretty early to say what we will deal with in September. If we have some results from the pilots, we may also present some results, and we will speak about how to establish a permanent tracking mechanism. So we have run the survey once. What we do next, how we do it, how we establish it as a regular process in our institution. In the countries of the partnership, we will have workshops. We will organize workshops for vet centers that will be announced by its partners. So stay tuned in our website to read the news. Closing this webinar, you will receive a survey, a small survey, feedback survey. This is to cultivate a feedback culture. So we will ask you to answer some few questions as a follow-up. And if you're interested to stay in touch with us to get more support, you can fill your email address. Otherwise, just leave it empty. It's the first time that I use this survey function in GoToWebinar, so I don't know exactly how it works. It may pop up now, and then you may receive it as an email. Anyway, if you answer once, it's enough. Don't answer twice, just to have an indication how useful is the webinar and how we can improve in the future. So I think that's all. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for participating in the webinar. We hope that it's informative. We hope that you have developed a motivation to do this, either using our methodology or using your own methodology. The important thing is, to do something to have real information and use it in your quality management system. Thank you. Bye-bye from me.
Bye-bye from me too, and thank you to Mr. Mario Feliz Esperanza for his very kind words. So until the third webinar in September, stay safe, stay healthy, stay well, and coronavirus free, of course, and we wish you in advance to have a great and terrific summertime. Goodbye, everyone, and thank you very much for attending.
Bye-bye. Και το κλείνουμε.